Tonight's meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals is being recorded for RCTV Live, Comcast Channel 22, or Verizon Channel 33. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Rob. Check rctv.org for more information and for replay times. All right. We are here tonight for a continuation of a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Town Hall 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, today, Thursday, July 20th, 2017, at 7 p.m. on the petition of Alyssa and Evan Gallegos, who seek a special permit under sections 532 and 5472 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct an addition 36 by 46 feet and to alter the interior of the existing dwelling for the purpose of an accessory apartment on the property at 320 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts. The petitioner is reminded that all testimony is under oath. You're all still under oath from the last hearing. And the floor is yours.
Okay. All right. When we came 2 weeks ago, we were asked to make sure that the second egress was in the correct location. So our architect has since moved the deck with the second egress further down, and Glenn said that looked good. And we were also needing to make sure that our square footage was 1/3 of the primary residence, so we have made those changes. This morning, we believe we had that correct. This morning we were told that there was some concern about the staircase, which we believe is a shared space, now being considered. It's really tricky in the wording. I think Glenn said it's debatable, but depending on how you want to determine that, if some people consider that also part of the accessory apartment, we reworked the plans so that the entryway and staircase leading up to the accessory apartment is now part of that, and we had to make the accessory apartment smaller so that we fit the number. So I believe Glenn did all the math and said it looks good. So these were cut off the press an hour ago to get them all, to have you all a copy. Glenn looked at it earlier today with the new plans and set everything looks good. So we're hoping for your approval so that we can move on and have our parents have their own suite next to us.
Great. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So we've all, I think, had an opportunity to take a look at the plans. Before we engage in any further board discussion, I think it makes sense for me to read into the record a letter from Glenn Redmond, the building inspector, so I'll go ahead and do that. Dated July 20, 2017, regarding 320 Lowell Street accessory apartment special permit application, addressed to me as the ZBA chairperson. I have reviewed the revised construction plans dated July 20th, 2017 for 320 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. For the proposed addition and accessory apartment, the basement finished area is now added to the total square foot of the principal dwelling, which allows the accessory apartment to be 1,000 square feet max. The 1,000 square feet accessory apartment consists of 132 square feet of access area that starts on the first floor access / mudroom in the second floor apartment of 868 square feet. This revised plan dated July 20th, 2017 does comply with section 5473. It is of my opinion that this request of a special permit be granted. Thank you, Glenn Redmond, Zoning Officer. All right, having read that into the record, I don't think we'll necessarily go in order. Are there any board members that wanna have any input, questions, or concerns for the applicant?
Obviously, I think she's met all the requirements now of the section for a special permit. I think the thing that you have to be cognizant of is before a building permit is issued, you're going to have to meet the requirements of being in an aquifer protection area and have a groundwater recharge system for precipitation runoff.
Sorry,
we did that, okay. And we have the dry wells. It's two wells. That's all been done. It's on
you don't have to convince
thing.
This board.
Yeah,
it's not part of the listing for a special permit, but it is something that you're going to have to be cognizant of for a building
permit. And we did it
already. And before you get there, my understanding is it has to be approved by the town engineer, that system. And so you're going to need somebody to design that and then get an approval of the town engineer.
I delivered it already.
Yeah.
They have it.
Okay.
Engineering department has it.
Okay.
I already did it.
Just so you know.
It'll be conditioned for it.
Because I, it should be conditioned. Yeah. So that's basically all I have in regards to that. I think those are the only loose ends from the last meeting. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other commentary? John?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I have some concerns about the... actually, it's the first criteria in the section. So the first criteria is that you must have two independent units, which means if you have two independent units, you can't cross between the two without adequate lock doors, and I'm not going to say firewall because that's up to the building inspector. I don't care anything about firewalls. I do care about the independence aspect of it. So the concern that I have is on the first and the second level. I'll start at the first one. When you enter into the mudroom is your main access area to your accessory apartment, is that correct?
Correct.
And that's in page 2 of your plans.
Yeah, I just had them backwards because I put the basement on the bottom since I figured we wouldn't be discussing that as much.
When you come into that, you also have apparent access from the garage into that area, into the mudroom area, and into the staircase leading upstairs. It looks like you have walled that off, but my question is, number one, who's using the garage? Just the accessory apartment or both parties?
Let's say both parties.
Okay, so how does a party in the main house get from the garage to the main portion of their house, which is actually the addition that you propose?
So, like right now, I have a standalone garage that we'd be taking.
No. This
right.
is the proposed, yes.
But, so I could walk out of my garage and walk in through the entry-covered porch door, or I could go through my front door.
Right.
Or I could go through the back of the garage and come in through the back of my house. So essentially, we could give my parents one set of key, lock that, so they have the same set that enters into the mudroom, that they could only have access to that and we could not have access to that.
Because you have a fire door from your unit into the mudroom, or I should say the addition into the mudroom. You have a fire door into from the garage into the mudroom again, and then there is nothing preventing anybody from going upstairs to the accessory apartment, because the entire accessory apartment is on the second floor, correct? But the access to the accessory apartment is on the first floor.
Yeah, because you have to be able to...
Absolutely.
I
understand
mean, you
that.
Can't.
I understand that.
Right.
The fire door, I assume, as you said, would be locked, but that's... That, in my mind, is not an independent. But that's just one issue that I have. When I go to the second floor, as you get up to the second floor, you come up the stairs, and where do you go?
You come up the second stairs, and there's the opening, and their door.
And where do you land when you get up the top of the stairs? And whose unit?
That is now considered the accessory. Because
that's
what
you, not according to your plans.
To the new plans that were drawn up today?
Where are they?
You were given to them.
Oh, yeah, there's a new set of plans.
We took that 132 square feet that you were concerned about and turned that into accessory apartment.
Okay.
So that is now
of theirs. They just dropped off new plans today that we just got our hands on today. So they amended certain things that may answer your questions.
Okay. I mean, I would be asking these questions if I saw the second
Well, that's what I said when I introduced it, that I said I just got them.
Right, yeah.
Because the last question was, these plans that I was working on was the 13th and Glenn referred to the 20th, and I didn't have any 20th plans.
Oh, yeah, you did, but you just didn't know that. Yeah, I mean, literally, they just handed them in at the beginning of the hearing, prior to
okay.
the hearing.
So my question still becomes, on the third page, when you get up to the second floor, whose unit are you in before you go into the accessory apartment?
When you get up at the top of the stairs,
right.
is like just a landing,
right.
because you don't open a door at the top of the
there's
stair.
No, correct. There's the only door that you have.
So that door goes into the accessory apartment.
Yes, but as you go up the stairs, whose unit are you in? It appears that you're in the extension of the primary domicile, which means there's no break between the accessory apartment.
I think that
yeah,
has
there's,
been
there's a fire door
there's
now.
There's a firewall there.
There's a fire door wall now.
We were
that goes to the back to the original residence.
Yeah.
So you get to the top of the stairs, goes accessory, and then right to the left there, that door goes to the main entrance, main house.
So there's two doors there.
Yes.
One door that it shows now is a four. Is that a 4 foot opening?
Yes.
4 foot opening. That's a fire door, and that's going to be closed and locked too.
Yeah, it's 4 feet to the wall line, but it's a 3 foot door.
3 foot door.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because may I speak? Yeah. On the under 5.4E, where it mentions about all stairways to the primary entrance to an accessory apartment located on a second or third story of a principal single family dwelling shall be enclosed within the exterior walls of the principal dwelling. So in other words, it has to be outside the principal dwelling. So we went beside what would be considered the exterior wall of the principal dwelling, unless otherwise required by applicable state. So in other words, the firewall now is between the stairway and the primary residence. So it would be considered that stairway is exterior to the principal dwelling. And that's what it says here, so that's what we did.
Well, again, the only thing I'm looking for, if the building inspector is happy with this, then who am I to question how this is going to go down? I just don't want to be a part of a board making a decision and find that 10 years down the road, there's a calamity and there's intermixing and the unit has been rented out to somebody and somebody gets hurt. Because right now there is one, two, three, four, five. There's five fire doors on the staircase. Three of them are going to the principal dwelling, which is outside the staircase, and two of them are going to the accessory apartment.
I will say
that if the building inspector is happy with this, that's his decision. I may or may not be happy with that, but that's the...
Plus, I think it has to go through the jurisdiction of the fire department. So if they see that there's a safety issue with that and we need to either not have as many doors, to my thinking, it's probably better to have more accessibility to be able to get out for everyone concerned. But if the fire department looked at it a different way, we would acquiesce to whatever they recommend.
See, at the present time, a family is in the house, is in the primary, is in the addition, is in the accessory. So leaving the doors open is no big problem at all. Somewhere down the line, however, when that accessory gets rented out to somebody else, which it can easily be, that's the intent of the accessory apartment, there could be problems that arise.
Well, our intent is not to rent it. We're living together already. We just need more space. So the thing is for us to project what's going to happen like in 10 years or whatever, as you say, who knows what the bylaws will have been amended to say that might address that.
And we are sticking to the bylaws, everything we've done.
Yes, we are. Believe me, I have scrutinized this. And for instance, on 5.473B, it says an accessory apartment shall have a gross floor area not to exceed the lesser of 1,000 square feet or one-third of the gross floor area of the principal family dwelling on the lot, exclusive of any garage, unfinished basement, shed, or other accessory structure thereon. I know you may have a certain interpretation, but to me, the stairway is an accessory structure thereon. If that stairway was built on the outside of the garage, not with the firewall between, it's, in other words, could it be on the other side of the garage, and then it wouldn't be considered part of the accessory apartment? It clearly states here, all stairways, this is under E, all stairways to the primary entrance to an accessory apartment located on the second or third story of a principal single family dwelling shall be enclosed. It does not say, where does the primary entrance, where does the accessory apartment start? I say right here, the stairway to the primary entrance. You can't count the square footage of an accessory apartment. It starts at the primary entrance where the stairs bring you. So I do not even see that the stairway, to me, for safety reasons and everything else, if that's what you're, you know, considering, the welfare of the citizens, and in the future, it can be addressed and fine-tuned. But right now, it clearly states the accessory apartments starts at the front door, whether it's on the second floor or the first floor. So I think that we're upholding everything that's here. I don't know what else we can do. I told you before, I'm willing to do anything. But our intent is to live together as a happy family and us to be with our grandchildren and to make it look beautiful and enhance our lives. And we are following the laws, the bylaws, the regulations. And there's nothing in there about how many doors or anything. It's, we are following what this states. If in fact something, I know we're the test case or whatever, the first case, but if in fact some things develop, then it's the right of town meeting with your you know, provision and your advisement to tweak this and do something. But right now, we are following this to the letter of the law, and I just don't know what else, you know, we can say. I'm just looking forward to us being together, having a nice, looks like a one family house, enhanced Lowell Street. We have the space, and I think it's for the betterment of the community that it would look so really nice. And our children, our grandchildren have moved back here because of what we love in Reading. Up in here, we bought the house in December of 1969. My daughter, because her husband was with the Air Force, was all over the country. And when she had a chance to come back here, because he's now a pilot for a commercial airline, he's from Arizona. He knew family and this community was so important to our daughter. She searched and she looked. She has two sons, one daughter. They love sports. They love everything. They're very good. The daughter is a field hockey player. And the thing was, she looked at other communities, and we checked, and Reading had the youth program. She's only 11 years old, and she is a dynamo, and she loves it. And I don't mean to be carrying off like this. I don't mean to say that, but I'm saying we all love Reading. I was on town meeting. I was in the first recycling thing with Return, if you remember that, Reading Zephyr 2, Undertake Recycling Now. I love Reading, and they love Reading now, and we're only trying to do like almost the old-fashioned way of a family living together and grandparents helping and so forth. That's all our purpose is, and But my husband and I would like a nice looking place. We don't want to be living in a closet and live, you know, so this is going to be nice. And it's a chance for us to have something new. And believe me, I'm putting a lot of thought into this, and I just would appreciate a favorable, in our favor to consider that we, you know, and I'd love to afterwards, if you ever wanted to do anything with accessory apartments and you want me to study it and do anything and see if there's problems, I'd be happy to be on an advisory board because it's that important. I don't want to see things going up and everything, and I see lots of big houses being divided into apartments and all that. This is not going to look like that. So I, as I say, I love Reading.
Any further comments or questions? Eric, any further comments or
Absolutely
questions?
Absolutely none.
All right. So we've had an opportunity to address board members' concerns. We've had an opportunity to hear from the applicant. Hearing that the board has no further questions regarding the application at this time, I'll go ahead and open up the matter to any further public comment. Is there anybody here that wants to speak? Not the applicant, but anybody else that wants to speak to the application? Going once, going twice. Okay, we'll close the public hearing portion of our matter tonight. And barring any further comment, I think we'll take a vote. I will entertain a motion from one of the members of the board.
Sure, Bob. Drafted something
yeah.
up here.
Sure.
I'll move to grant petitioners Lisa and Evren Galagos. Galagos. A special permit under sections 5.3.2 and 5.4.7.2 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct in addition 36 foot by 46 foot and to alter the interior of the existing dwelling for the purpose of an accessory apartment on the property located at 320 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. As shown on the certified plot plan prepared by LeBlanc Survey Associates, 161 Holton Street, Danvers, Mass, dated May 16, 2017, and stamped by Registered Land Surveyor in Massachusetts, Vernon J. LeBlanc. And also in general conformance with the submitted architectural plans prepared by JustDrawIt.com is the name of the company, 133B Main Street, North Reading, Mass, dated May 2, 2017, revised most recently July 20th, 2017. Plans numbered A101, A102, A103, with the following conditions. As the property is located in the town's aquifer protection district, the applicant must install a town-approved artificial recharge system for precipitation runoff in accordance with town bylaws, section 10.3.3.1i. Condition two, petitioner shall submit to the building inspector a certified plot plan showing proposed construction and proposed foundation prior to issuance of a foundation permit for the work. Number three, petitioner's final construction plans for new addition shall be submitted to the building inspector along with an as-built foundation plan prior to the issuance of a building permit for the superstructure. And number four, as-built plans showing the completed construction shall be submitted to the building inspector immediately after the work is completed and prior to the issuance of an occupancy permit.
That's the motion?
Yeah. Any questions?
Do we have a second?
I have a question on that. Will I get that? When we get that in writing, that'll be.
Absolutely.
Later.
Yeah.
This will be part of the board's decision.
After the vote. And David will go over that with you.
Sure. All right, so we have a motion on the table. Do we have a second?
Second.
Eric, second. Any further discussion on the motion as made and seconded? Hearing none, all those in favor? All those opposed? Did you vote?
It appears that I abstained, but I really should vote.
I don't think you can abstain. You can't abstain. You've been part of the hearing. Do you have a conflict that prevents you from being able to vote?
Nope.
I think that would be, we don't follow Robert's rules, but the only grounds for abstention would technically be if you had a conflict or otherwise were not properly informed to make a decision and to cast a vote. We'll talk about this with town council afterwards, perhaps.
Okay.
But I think it behooves you to cast a vote. Shall we revote to give you that opportunity?
I'm not going to be sure.
Okay. All right, so we have a motion made and seconded. No further discussion being heard on that motion. All right.
I will say that I will vote in favor of the motion, knowing full well that the basic criteria and the decision of the building inspector to follow through is the critical aspect of this. So I'm going to vote in favor.
We've read the building inspector's comments in the record. So that is part of the record. And I think that has been the building inspector's recommendation based upon the plans that he's reviewed, and he reviewed these drawings dated today, specifically passing upon the content of those drawings. So I think your point is well taken and has been incorporated into the record. So for the purposes of confirming the vote, all those in favor of the application? Okay. None opposed. Your application is granted, 500. Give me a moment. I will stamp documents that you need to take with you. The board has 14 days to write up the decision. And then there's an appeal period that has to pass. So about a month. Check in with Kim. She'll be able to provide you with any updates that you're looking for. But you'll want to take drawings, the documents I'm going to stamp, I'll hand them over to you in a moment. Okay?
Thank you, Rick.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Boy, I hope size okay.
Yeah. Needless to say, David, I'll write that.
Yeah, please do. Yeah. If the applicant would approach, I'll give you your documents and you can be on your way.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for your patience while we work through it.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And I just want to say, as a citizen of Reading, I appreciate that we have this leadership that can devote this volunteer time and also scrutinize everything so carefully, because we do want to maintain the caliber and the beauty of.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Pam. Bye. I'll see you. Bye now. Thank you. Good night. Thank you. You have a set of those plans? You want to stick a set of those plans in the file?
Nope, I have a set.
You have them?
Yep.
Okay, good. All right, next item on the agenda is the board's discussion on the closed case 1701-40B petition at 172 Auburn Street. Town Council has arrived.
Hello, everyone.
And we're in a position to offer what I think might be any last minute housekeeping or perhaps grammatical or even perhaps substantive, but I took a look at it. I don't have anything to add. And I think this is an opportunity for board members, and the five board members here are the voting members for this case, since we've all gotten our Mullen Rule stuff in, to be able to perhaps even get to a point where we're ready to vote on this decision tonight. And so we'll have at it. Do any of the board members, well, since we've been here last, what's been updated?
Very, very little. There were a couple of changes that I had in my email inbox when we were last together from the applicant, and a couple from Mass Housing Partnership, which is the applicant's state subsidizing agency. But all of those changes I would characterize as like typo and very, very minor adjustments. For example, a couple places in the decision I had previously referred to the subsidizing agency as Mass Housing, MHP, so we just switched it. And there were a handful of ones like that. That's really about it. Other than that, I think in all other respects, the substance of the decision that you have before you now is the same as it was in prior drafts that you guys have had for a bit now. I struggle to think of any meaningful substantive change that needs to be brought to your attention. I do think that this is all at this point down to very, very minor changes, and I'm obviously happy to make any additional changes that you guys want to see in your decision, but from my perspective, I think it's ready to go, and the applicant has signed off on it as well.
Anybody who has any commentary, questions, comments, go ahead and chime in. Robert, go ahead.
Yeah, one thing, Chris, on page 9.
Yep.
We coming down the sheet about a third of the way down, you made a correction there, I see. And I see a date in there for the lighting detail specification submitted for the April 6, 2016 public hearing. Should that be 2017?
That sure should.
I believe our first meeting was in January of 2017, so I'm thinking.
Yeah, what page are you on?
I'm on page 9.
Under general conditions?
Yeah. Conditions, yeah.
One, essentially.
Yeah, in section 1, towards the end of it.
Yeah.
They talked the photometric plan entitled da 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 apartment building 172 Auburn Street.
Yeah.
Prepared by Vanguard Lighting, dated. And I assume that's correct too, the 10/30/2016, along with the lighting detail specification submitted for the April 6th, 2017 meeting. Should that be?
Yes, that should absolutely be 2017.
Okay.
Yeah.
There was that one. And then the only other thing I saw was at the end, when we got into the condition, all these numbers here. All the same thing, into the general conditions. But now I'm looking at, as we get down to number 52, and we started changing some numbers around. I assume maybe the program, the software, is going to get those numbers correctly down there. But it goes from 51, and then 52 is eliminated. 53 should be 52, and then 54 is 53, and then there's another 54.
Okay. That should be cleaned up in the...
I would think it should be in the software.
Track changes that'll clean up when you accept them.
Yeah, it looked like number 52 for somehow was
overlooked. One got moved around or renumbered.
Okay.
But no, I've got a clean version here that's been the numbering.
That's the only, those are the only two issues that I saw when I read through it.
Nick, you had some...
Yeah, just hope you can clarify this. The deed restriction on affordability, is it perpetuity?
The deed restriction is not in perpetuity. The deed and it's not, it's a affordable housing restriction that goes in place, and it is, it runs for, I believe, 30 years or the life of the mortgage, whichever is sooner. So if they pay off their mortgage to MHP sooner, the affordability restriction can theoretically go away. I attempted to remedy that by adding in new condition 54, which just goes, which basically says, regardless of what the recorded affordability restriction with MHP says, there, the affordable units always need to be in place based on our decision. So if their restriction expires, they got to put another one in place based on this.
Okay, so this, in this decision, it's saying pretty much based on this board, it's in perpetuity?
Yeah, exactly.
And does this get recorded at the Registry of Deeds?
This does get recorded.
Okay.
It goes against the land forever. And you know, and so there's a condition in here that says it. It's also a general rule of 40B that as long as the project, so we put the condition in to be sort of belt and suspenders, but even if we hadn't put that condition in, as long as the project does not comply with local zoning and basically needs the 40B approval in order to exist, then they have to maintain the units. So the restrictions can come and go, probably not for 50 and 30 years, but the affordability will always remain.
So what, if anything, would change if Reading was above 10% and in compliance?
Nothing. With respect to the project, nothing would change. They would need to maintain their affordable units and even if we went above the 10%.
Okay. Thanks.
Good. Anything else? No? John, did you have any questions?
On the 52 that you were taking on, that... to me indicates a clerk of the works, more or less, for the project. Is that what the intent of the project control was going to be? And if indeed that that is going to be removed, who then operates as the clerk of the works as this goes through? Is that the building inspector, or?
If you wouldn't mind, could you, I don't have the red line. I don't have
page 15.
What I deleted. Okay. I took that number 52 out in response to a comment from MHP. They don't like to see it. You get this with not just MHP, but all of the agencies that do this kind of work on the state level. They don't want to see anything in the 40B decision stepping on whatever restrictions they're going to layer on top of the project. So it's you end up oftentimes with contest between the ZBA locally and the subsidizing agency of the state. The ZBA tries to just sort of do state stuff, and the state says, no, don't do that. So this, it, you know, says that the comprehensive permit controls everything if there's any conflict. That isn't really true if the regulatory agreement or any of the state-level stuff works differently than what the comprehensive permit says. But so I don't think it matters. This comprehensive permit, whether we put that 52 in there or not, controls all the zoning stuff that we need to control. The building commissioner will have the authority to review everything that the building commissioner would ordinarily review. All deleting this does is just eliminate a potential headache in terms of the relationship between this permit, the applicant, and MHP.
So the Housing Authority then becomes the final, more or less, say on this. It takes it out of the hands for the question of what is or what is not being designated in the comprehensive permit, and allows Mass Housing to determine that.
Not really. All Mass Housing is going to do is they're going to enter into the regulatory agreement that's going to they're going to loan the applicant money, then they're going to enter into a regulatory agreement that governs the affordability of the particular of the four units that are going to be affordable. That's and that is properly something within their jurisdiction. We don't look at or tinker with the regulatory agreement. That's a state standardized document that gets put in place for these kinds of projects based on the state level review. So that stuff is within their purview. We don't want to get too deep into that in this decision. But flip side of that coin is that they don't do any of the zoning stuff. You know, we're this decision governs the waivers, construction management, building commissioner review, all of that stuff will remain in place in town hall and not get disturbed by MHP in any way that I can think of.
Okay. That's the only thing that I...
Right.
Eric, any comments, questions? Nope. No, and I don't either. But good catch by those who caught some, and glad that we have some questions. Now that we've gone through that, I would imagine that we ought to vote this and let town council finish it up, firm it up, and we can publish it. Now, as part of the decision, there is a proposed vote, and so we ought to have a member make that motion. It's on page 3 of our marked up copy where it starts voted. And so I imagine that our motion should sound something like that. And I think town council's made it easy for us. So, first of all, are we all in agreement that we're ready to vote this? Okay, hearing no opposition to that. Who wants to read the motion into the record? Somebody can. Anybody? Nobody has to write anything. Town council's done all the drafting. Go ahead, John.
Motion to grant the applicant the application of Reading Equitable Housing LLC for comprehensive permit under Master of Laws Chapter 40B for 20-unit multifamily residential development with 4 units restricted so as to be available for rent by household earnings at or below 50% of the Boston area median income within the existing 3-story structure located at 172 to 180 Woburn Street, Reading, Mass., together with parking related infrastructure and amenities as shown on the approved plans referenced in this decision and subject to the findings, waivers, and conditions set forth herein.
Do we need a roll call vote?
You don't.
Okay. All right. So that's been, that motion is on the table. Do we have a second? Second by Robert. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? The application is granted 500. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you, guys. I wish they were all like that.
Exactly.
That was a remarkable hearing. So I guess what I suggest now is I've got one edit to make and plug in the vote 5-0, which I can do. What I'd suggest is we have you guys sign a signature page tonight because you're all here. Leave that with Kim. I can email Kim a very, very slightly revised version tomorrow, and then we can file it with the town clerk at some point tomorrow.
Right.
Oh, Monday.
Oh, you got one? All right, good.
Yeah. Jamal?
Yes, is it appropriate to have you answer a question relative to both of the two earlier this evening?
No, thank you.
I don't blame you.
Of course.
Well, I must say that I don't remember ever having been a member of this board or a board in the years that I've been on it where there has been an abstention. But I don't know if that's appropriate or inappropriate.
You tried to abstain once before.
Did I?
I sit on my local zoning board of appeals, and I've got a guy who sits next to me who often votes present.
Votes what?
Present. which isn't that terribly helpful for anybody. I think David's right that if there was a conflict, you know, that's a reason to step down and not vote. But I'm not aware of any legal requirement in 40A that says you, as a sitting member, must absolutely vote on an application that's in front of you. So I think it's probably not good practice to abstain unless you've got a, you know, I was only here for part of the hearing. If you can articulate a good reason as to why you're doing it, then maybe that's appropriate. I think the difficult, so backing up, I don't know of any rule that says it can't under any circumstances happen. The difficulty is if it could only ever happen really for one, when you've only got five of you sitting here, you know, you could only suffer one abstention and still remain a functioning board. If you get the second abstention, then you don't have a quorum because you need four votes in order to grant the relief. So that's not actually an answer to the question. I can keep thinking about it, but I can't point to a prohibition on abstentions, but better practice, I think, is to vote operative.
That satisfies.
Yeah, and I guess, but as a practical matter, you've sat through the hearing, you've heard the testimony, you've rendered, formed an opinion as to whether or not the application meets with or doesn't meet with the rules for the bylaw or the request for relief from the bylaw. And so it would seem at that point, if you found that you were not able to cast a vote, I think as Chris said, it would perhaps be something that you would want to articulate as to why you would want to abstain. And I think as chair, I would exercise a prerogative to call, you know, put your, hold your feet to the fire. And if you tell me I don't want to vote, I don't feel like it, not that you would, then I would probably say that's not good practice and not good, not proper decorum. If you said, well, now I just discovered that I know the applicant, I have some sort of a conflict that prevents me from being able to be impartial or render a good decision, whatever reason that might be, then, barring any violation of the, lack of a quorum, then fine. But I think if you're here and you heard the case, you ought to vote on it. But and vote it up or down. I mean, like you said, we need four.
I think that's a good point, and I'd always back up the chair's prerogative to hold people's feet to the fire. But on top of that, each of you should have a reason for doing everything that you do up here. And if you're gonna vote no, I mean, to some extent, an abstention could be a basis for not articulating a reason for what you're doing. You know, if you're voting for something, even if you're not going through each and every section of the bylaw, you're implicitly saying that, the application satisfies the criteria in your bylaw. If you're voting against something, you ought to be able to point to one of those criteria that you think is not met. And you might be less inclined to go through that exercise if you're abstaining as opposed to voting yes or no.
And I think that's important in case our decision gets challenged.
Right.
as we know, is not all that infrequent. So, yeah, I mean, just good practice, you know, good feedback, good practice.
Actually, it has been relatively infrequent.
Well, since I've been on the board, there's been probably two or three, maybe four, that we've gotten served on. My first order of business after having been sworn in on the board was to get served in my mailbox at home on a lawsuit appealing a decision that I wasn't even part of. But it does happen.
Listed. I know that.
But we ought to, as Chris says, we ought to make sure that we're putting together well-informed decisions, and I think voting is the key to that. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you all.
Thanks for your help on this one, too.
It's been a pleasure on this one.
Catch you on the next one.
Yeah. hopefully as uncontroversial as this one.
All right. Safe home.
Thank you.
Good night.
All right. We don't have anything else on the agenda tonight. There was some, you know, perhaps maybe minutes, but I think Julie put them on for our next meeting.
Yeah.
On the 3rd of August. So with nothing else on the agenda, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Eric, second? John? All right, all those in favor, we are adjourned.